Luke chapter 11. Go there in your Bibles, on your phones, whatever you got with you. If you don't have anything, would like to borrow a Bible, you can raise your hand. One of our volunteers will be happy to bring you one. You can use that this morning. You can keep it if you don't have one, or would just like a new one. It's our gift to you. We're going to jump right in. This passage, it should be very familiar to you. We actually prayed a longer version of what we're going to read today in the prayer time we had earlier. But we, just for those of you who haven't been with us, just to kind of catch you up, we've been going through chapter 11 in Luke as Jesus was modeling prayer, showing that prayer was modeled. And for us, that was important to him. And we said as a church that we want it to be important to us. But the only way that it really can be important to us is for us to prove that's important, to make it important. So we've begun to ingrain it in our services and pretty much everything that we do. And so we're trying to model it as Jesus modeled it, because our willingness to pray reveals the depth of our faith. And we said that for the first week. But prayer is something that can be learned. As the disciples reached out and said, teach us to pray, we know that prayer is something that can be learned. And when we learn to pray, we learn to worship. And that's kind of the overarching theme of what we're going to be talking about all semester. But to learn how to worship God, we really have to start where worship starts. And we are saying that the foundation of proper worship is proper prayer. So today we're going to look at how prayer is focused, right? We're going to look at Jesus' definitive instruction for prayer and see that focused prayer is favored prayer. Focused prayer is favored prayer. So let's jump into chapter 11, and we'll just start at verse 1, and we'll read through the end of the prayer that he instructs us to pray. So starting verse 1. Now Jesus was praying at a certain place, and when he finished, one of his disciples said to him, Lord, teach us to pray, as John taught his disciples. And he said to them, when you pray, say, Father, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come. Give us each day our daily bread. Forgive us of our sins, for we ourselves forgive everyone who is indebted to us. And lead us not into temptation. All right, let's pause right there. Now, I know some of you are like, yeah, I think that had more words in it last time I read that. I think some things are missing. This is a parallel of Matthew 6, which has more descriptors, but the structure is still the same. The structure is still the same. He's still teaching the same things. Nothing has changed. And this is very important, because it's telling us not every prayer has to be like this, right? But our prayer life should include these things. If we're going to pray properly, we should see what prayer really should look like, right? Now, I know that when we think about prayer, we pray before a meal, okay? That's very common. I think many of us do that. We will say, God bless us for this food, thank you for this day, whatever we say, say something pretty basic, and then we eat, right? Okay, good. It's blessed, I guess, because somehow he breaks down some of the fatty tissue. I don't know what he does when he does that, hopefully that the cheeseburger is more like a salad, if he can make that work, but he doesn't. He could. I don't think he does. Sometimes we pray for people. We're praying for specific things, right? That's great. We can communicate to God in many different ways for many different reasons. And what Jesus is saying here, though, is that there's a proper perspective of prayer. That prayer is focused. That if every prayer doesn't have to be like this, but if this is not included in our prayer life, if this is not included in how we pray, then we're missing something. Then we're creating noise, or our prayer life is incomplete, or maybe out of focus, right? So it starts with a pause. His instructions start with a pause. And then he gives us three focuses on God, and then three focuses on us. And the pause is, this is my take on this, and it's interesting to me, or at least this is how I see it. What's the very first word? What do we start with? Father. That's right. I think Father is an opening pause. I think it's a start that should cause us to stop. The word Father is so deep. If we will not just say it and move on past it, if we'll reflect and think about what it actually means, I think it'll take our breath away. So Father, in this, in Aramaic, right, is Abba. That's probably how Jesus would have said it out loud in the language he was speaking. Abba, Father. And I've heard some people say like daddy, and it's not daddy loosely, like it's something fun or personal. It's actually a term of endearment that adults would use, and they would call their father Abba, father, right? And so it's a term of respect. It's a term of reverence, and it's a term of relationship. And I'm not saying that you can't say daddy, but I'm saying that father is not a child saying this to father. It's not an immature term. It is a mature term that's deeper. So I just want us to be on the same page. Nothing wrong with saying daddy, but I'm saying that father is respectful. It's full of reverence, and it implies a relationship. So before we even get into the prayer, we begin remembering we belong. And that's so huge. We begin remembering we belong, and that should cause us to pause. Now, as I've been reading about this and studying this, preparing to talk about this, I've noticed that when I pray, and maybe you have over the last few weeks, I've noticed everywhere I pray, where I'm praying for a meal, I'm praying for my family, I'm praying anywhere, and I start, Father, I connect with what we're about to talk about, and I can't say anything else for a second. It reminds me that he is not commanding us to come to him saying, Master. Why? Because he's freed us. He's freed us because he loves us, and he wants a relationship with us, but not a buddy relationship. He's redeemed us back into the family, and so he's adopted us as sons and daughters. And so when Jesus says his instructions to pray, and he says that we're supposed to come to him and say, Father, what he's saying is that we're allowed that connection to him. We're allowed that term because he sees us as a child of his. He sees us as a part of his family. It's a father comes to him and says, yes, I'm ready. I'm here to listen. What is it? It's not slave to master. It's not this, we still come in reverence, but there's this relational component that's so personal that we get to call him Father, that we get to approach him in that way. And I don't know about you, but just thinking about how much his love extends to me to be able to give me permission to call him Father is humbling. And right at the beginning, before we get anywhere into the prayer, I think it stirs up an enormous amount of emotions. It should stir a whole bunch of emotions, humility and joy and fear and peace and just an overwhelming rush of emotions before we even get to the prayer, because Father is what we get to call him and what we're supposed to call him. Father is the opening pause. Because if we rush past that, then we miss the relationship. We miss the love. We miss that access, that redemptive, that adoption, everything that comes from that term, that single term, Father. It's beautiful. I love it. And I have found myself just getting caught up in it for sure. So it starts there, Father. Father. And then we get into the three focuses on him. And the first focus is, hallowed be your name. Hallowed is Old English for holy, right? Hallowed be your name. This focus is on his everlasting glory. Now, I don't know about you, but when I read the Bible, I'm always trying to dig a little bit, and I come across something that doesn't make sense. I ask questions. Why is that? That doesn't make sense. What's going on here? You know, who's supposed to say that? Everyone's supposed to say that. I start asking a lot of questions. And so when I read that, Father, oh, wow, that's huge. That's deep. Holy is your name. How will it be your name? The first thing I think of is, why do I need to tell him his name is holy? His name is holy. Holy be your name. How will it be your name? It's already holy. Am I praying that it's holier? Am I coming to God asking that he make his name holier than it is? And that's not even possible. So I start thinking about why this is here, why this prayer starts with, how will it be your name? Be holier. Your name, be holier. Is it even possible? Why would we pray it? Well, we pray, again, prayer, it's not for God. The prayer is for us. And so the picture of holy be your name is not that his name be holy because it's not already, but his name be holy in our perspective. That as we approach him, we think about him, that's how we see him. We call him Father, but he is Holy Father. We see him for what he has done. We see him for who he is. We acknowledge all that we have in his word, right? What he is, what he's done, and we approach him with the proper perspective. This is about reflecting on whether or not we truly believe that he is who he says he is, and that we truly believe he can do what we would ask him to do. Holy is your name. How will it be your name? It's a start for us to align our heart. Now, I've read several books on prayer. Everybody has different opinions about this, and one of the further steps of not just seeing him as holy and aligning our hearts so that we recognize who we're talking to, but there's also this picture of Galatians 3:27 being clothed in Christ, right? We wear his name, so his name being holy, it's us kind of carrying that name. Like we are expressing through our prayer to those around us, to those we're praying to ourselves. Like we carry the name of his holiness. And so we have to make sure that what we are proclaiming is a holy Father and not something less holy. So there's a burden on us to make sure that our heart is aligned and that we have the proper perspective. And that's before we ever get into it. So it starts with this amazing gratitude, Father, that I think causes us to pause just a little. Holy is your name is our starting place to make sure that we're not coming to him selfishly, pridefully. We come to him understanding, respecting, and acknowledging his holiness. So that's the first focus. Hallowed be your name, his everlasting glory. The second focus, he says, your kingdom come, which is focused on his eternal will. So if hallowed be your name is on what he's done, maybe looking at the past, then this is on the future. We go to Father God, thank you for this blessed day, and then we jump right into whatever we want to ask. And oftentimes we skip this part of the prayer. We skip this focus because what we really want to come to God, your Father, that's awesome. Wow, that's so cool. You were holy. All right, let me get to all the good stuff. I need to pray for this person. I need this and this. This needs to be fixed. This needs to work out. And we skip your kingdom come because we don't really want to think about his kingdom come. We're coming to him because our kingdom hurts right now. My kingdom is in need. We've already called him Father, and we've already said thanks. We've already said he's holy. Can't we just skip this? No, can't. Because skipping this is what creates all the clenched fist frustrations when it doesn't go our way or when it doesn't come at the time we want it to. And I was talking to someone before the service that was asking a question like, how often do we pray? How long do we pray before we stop praying? And there's never a stop praying. You pray for something once. If your kingdom come is the right perspective, then you're going to be patient whenever it's going to work out. God's going to answer it. It might not be the way you want him to. It might not be in the time you want him to. But if you skip over your kingdom come, then all of a sudden it's like, come on, why haven't you answered my prayer? How much more do I got to do? What's the deal? This isn't working out like it was supposed to. I read a story about a family. A family, they were praying for someone in their family was ill, and they were on their deathbed, and they were praying, they're offering up prayers, and there was a chaplain that visited often. He was there, and he came in and asked if he wanted to pray with them, and they said sure. So they prayed together, and they prayed, and she did not live, and so the chaplain came by and said, hey, I'd love to pray with you. I'm sorry for your loss. Can I pray with you? And their response was, no thanks. We did that. It didn't work. So we're done with that. That's skipping your kingdom come. Now, let me tell you another story. Because there are organizations, there are people who tell you to skip this. They teach that prayer is for you getting from God. In fact, I was at a conference once, many years ago, and I was there to hear a particular speaker, and we got there when he was scheduled to speak, but there was somebody else already speaking, and then there was somebody else that spoke, and then there was this other thing that happened, and it was like 3 hours before this guy, and so the people I were with were like, I'm ready to go. We've been here 3 hours. It's time to go. It's time to go. I really want to hear this guy speak. And just to kind of frame up the environment, I'm not going to say names. I'm not going to talk about the place. I'm not going to talk any of that, but there was an offering time, and they were passing the plate, and they sang a song. There was like a long message just for the offering, and then there was a song sung while they were passing the plates. I'm not making this up. I wish I had recorded it. I wish I could remember exactly the melody. I'd play it for you, but I remember lyrics that went something like this. I can't wait to drive my Mercedes-Benz. I can't wait to move in to my 5-bedroom mansion. Like, those were the lyrics of the song they were singing while they were passing the plate. I went, my God, I've never heard that song on the radio. That seems interesting, but okay, whatever. That's not a song I've heard. I've never heard that song before. It's odd. So so everyone's ready to go, and we're in the lobby, and I'm like, I gotta hear this guy. He's on the stage. I walk in, and he stands on the stage, and he says, I'm so glad to be here. I'm so glad to be here. Let me tell you what we're talking about tonight. The title of my message is Cash in Your Receipt. It's time to get back all God owes you. All right, good. I'm glad you guys responded that way, because the audience there did not respond. The audience responded, they went nuts. They all stood up, they clapped. I mean, they were like, woo, it's so awesome, it's so awesome. And I was like, that's not right. And I said, I'm done, I'm out. And so I left. Listen, God doesn't owe you anything. There is no receipt, right? There's no tally where you get to say, God, look, I did all these things. I prayed this many times. I've memorized this many scripture verses. I read this many books of the Bible. Look, all right, now you got to give to me. It doesn't work that way. Cash in a receipt. Man, I mean, it's craziness. It's craziness. But here's the deal. People teach that. And then they say, this skipping your kingdom come. They're saying, you pray my kingdom, my kingdom, my kingdom. And Jesus is saying, no. Listen, I mean, do you really want to worship a God that bends to you? Do you really want to worship a God that bends in your direction as opposed to demanding you bend in his? I mean, what kind of meaningful life is it if everything worked out the way you thought that it should? I mean, have we ever experienced something where we recognize after the fact, like, that was probably better, it didn't go the way I wanted it to? Yes. It's a much more meaningful life, and there's a much greater impact to worship a God that requires we bend in his direction instead of the other way around. So we cannot skip your kingdom come. Even if it costs us, even if it doesn't make sense, even if we hate the outcome, the reward is peace. The reward is joy if we don't skip your kingdom come. If we skip your kingdom come, then we're just mad and we're frustrated because we want it to be about us. Then we get to the third focus. Hallowed be your name, focus on everlasting glory. Your kingdom come, focus on his eternal will. And then give us which is a focus on everyday provision. And I know you're probably thinking, well, that isn't that a focus on me? Not really, because he says, give us each day our daily bread. And it's this is more of, it's a throwback to when the Israelites needed God. They trusted God would provide, and he did. He provided manna from heaven. But he told them, like, this is what you get every day. You got to throw it out. And it was a picture of him providing every day what they needed, just what they needed, and nothing more. And it was frustrated because they wanted to go back to Egypt and be in slavery but have steaks. But the God was saying, if you'll trust me, I promise, the end result is way better than what you want to go back to. And this throwback here, give us each day our daily bread, is a recognition that what we have or don't have, or what we will have or won't have, is exactly what God wants for us right now. And that means that we should be grateful. It is a statement of trust. And it ties back to your kingdom come, because when we don't skip your kingdom come, when we say your will be done, your kingdom come, your will be done, God, we're putting you first before we ask that you provide for us daily. We're saying that I trust that what you do provide for me daily is going to be what I need. And it may not be what I want, but I trust you in it. And if we have that trust, right, that means that we are content with what we have, faithful with what we have, or grateful for what we have, and we're preparing our heart and our mind for whatever is coming. We're trusting God is going to give us what we need, even if we don't get it in the moment, even if we don't understand why, even if it's a lesson we don't want to learn, we are trusting that God is giving us exactly what we need. And so when Jesus is instructing to pray, he's saying, hey, look, you start with just this beautiful gift of adoption into the family of God and being able to call him Father, which should cause you to pause. And then you call him holy. Make sure your heart is aligned. And then don't jump to your needs. Make sure that you understand that it's his kingdom, not yours, that we're ultimately desiring, which means that you're okay with whatever the outcome is and his daily provision. And our focus begins with him. And then it shifts to our focus on us. And he says, forgive us our sins. And this is not like we need to be resaved, right? It's not losing a salvation kind of thing. And it's not filling a bucket, you know, of sins and then dumping them out and then go filling them up again and dumping them out. It's not this abusing grace. This is recognizing that we've made mistakes. And the person that we have dishonored by our disobedience is owed an apology. We're sorry. Next time we're going to get it right. We're so moved by the cross, so grateful for what he has done, that it leads us to learn from our mistakes and get it right the next time. So Jesus is saying, you pray, forgive me, because I didn't do what I know I could do. And then look what it says next. Forgive us of our sins, which is focus on our vices, right? The things that we struggle with. But look at this. For we ourselves forgive everyone who is indebted to us, and we get this examine us focus. It doesn't say examine us, but here's the thing. We just pray that he would forgive us. We come to God because we believe that he will forgive us. We come to him because we need him to forgive us because we've made mistakes and we are sorry that we didn't do it the way it should have been done. But look at this. So if that's past, we made mistakes in the past. Look at this. Here's the present. Are we doing for those around us what we're expecting God to do for us? And so Jesus is saying part of this prayer is an examination of ourselves in the moment. Like, hey, are we actually doing, are we hoarding all of this grace and love from God for ourselves? Or are we learning from it and actually distributing it out? Because it says, for we ourselves forgive everyone who is indebted to us. Well, it's the question, is that true? Because I bet we all have cases of people that we've not done right by. So we examine and we focus on our victories, the times that we have done well, the things that we have done right. Because here it's saying we have forgiven everyone who's indebted to us. We have done what we're supposed to do. So it's a focus on where we have gotten right. If we focus on our mistakes, forgive us, then we focus on our victories. Yes. And then the last focus, he says, lead us not into temptation. And so here's the for the future. We're praying for strength, to focus on our values, the things that we want to do right. And we pray for strength to do right, that we glorify him with our choices and not dishonor him with our disobedience. Now, the question that I always ask when I read that, and I think about that, and we pray the Lord's Prayer, and Jesus says, pray like this in Matthew, and he says, say this, right? He's saying, this is what prayer should look like. Is he saying that every prayer should be like this? No. Is he saying that every time you pray, you should go through these steps like it's a checkbox? No. What's he saying? He's saying that if you're missing any of those focuses, your prayer is not focused like it should be. If you're skipping to your kingdom come, if you're skipping the how will it be your name, if you're skipping the forgive us, if you're skipping the examine us, if you're skipping the lead us because those things are just too inconvenient, then you're missing the point of prayer. The point of prayer is not just to cry out for things that we need. The point of prayer is to put us in that proper perspective, to get our priorities straight, to know who God is and who we are, to know that he can do it. And he will listen. But he is asking us to recognize him for who he is, to trust him, to be patient, to cling to him no matter what. And that's what makes praying prayer so challenging, praying prayer properly so challenging. Because we want prayer just to be about us. We want to come straight to God with our needs. We want to cry out and say, fix this, heal that, move this, do that. And God is saying, know who you're talking to. Focused prayer is favored prayer. In Isaiah 66:2, he says this, this is the one to whom I will look, he who is humble and contrite in spirit and trembles at my word. Do you pray humbly? Do you pray broken and contrite in your heart? Do you come to God and acknowledge him as holy? Do you put his kingdom before yours? Are you okay with what he has given you? Do you confess your sin? Do you rejoice in the victories when you forgive and love like you're supposed to? Not in a prideful, arrogant way? All this is Jesus saying, we can pray better. We can pray better. We can be more focused in our prayer. And when our prayer is more focused, when we come to him as Father first, and we know what that means, and it causes us to pause, and we proclaim him as holy and believe that in our heart, that it's not just us crying out and saying, God, do something, but that we believe who he is and what he's done, and we acknowledge that in our heart, and it's truly aligned to his. And if we put his kingdom before ours and are totally okay with the outcome, even if it's not more than we wanted, our prayer is becoming more focused. And focused prayer is favored prayer. And asking to forgive sins means we have to admit fault, and that's hard for everyone. Proclaiming victories and examination, we have to do that. We have to step back and say, am I forgiving people that need to be forgiven? Am I loving the way that I should be loving? And asking God to give us the strength to do it right the next time. That's what prayer is. Now, we still pray for meals. We still pray for people and all that's really great. But if that's all your prayer is, you're missing the bigger picture. Don't miss the instruction of what proper prayer looks like. It's a perspective. It's focused. And it's favored. Let's pray. Father. I don't want to ever lose the power that is in that single word, Father. To never be in such a hurry that it doesn't cause me to pause. Thank you for your love, redeeming me into your family, all the people here that you call your own. Their hearts are grateful that they get it and understand who you are and what you've done and why it matters. Because you are holy, you are good, you are righteous, and you are what we need over anything else. And it must be your will above ours, your kingdom over ours, so that we can know for sure the plans you have, the purpose you have, the lessons you're teaching, what you desire us to do. And we look at what we have, the people around us, and are grateful and content and faithful to utilize it for your glory. I pray for everyone in this room that we will have the courage to come to you and ask for forgiveness, to say we're sorry that we didn't do what we know we should have done. To come to you and thank you for the strength to forgive someone we did not want to forgive. To love someone we didn't think deserved to be loved. Knowing that we couldn't have done it without you. That everybody in this room would pray for strength to overcome our failures, our slip-ups, and make less mistakes going forward. To be more about honoring you than disobeying you. Father, may every person in this room have the courage to focus their prayer. That is what you favor. And we pray that in Jesus' name. Amen.